Right, we're going to pick up with the second article. I'm going to follow up an article we wrote before about a ring, which is made out of orichalcum. Now, in our first article, we actually went through the science and proved this ring is unique, and that it is this particular element or this alloy, and that it's not made anymore. And really, what we came down to was two possibilities. It came from Atlantis or it came from Rome. Came from the Roman Empire, because we do know in the 6th century some ingots and coins were found that had orichalcum in them. Now, what we also know is from the Romans again, they Pliny the Elder said in the 1st century the mines were exhausted. But remember, this was actually found in the 6th century, and it's possible there was still one mine at the time they were mining from, and they've exhausted that one. So that is a possibility. But the point to bear in mind is that was made as ingots and coin. It was not like this thing here. It wasn't like this ring. Okay, there's a difference there. So what have we got? It's Roman or Atlantean. Now, the important part is the markings on the ring. Now, the markings on the ring turn out to be primarily, from what we can gather, and this is what the third article is about, Atlantean, because the two markings on there, one is the Berber sign for Atlas, the son of Poseidon, who came from Atlantis. And that's where you get the word Atlantis from. And the other symbol, we believe, to represent Atlantis. Now, the reason we think that's the case is because there are five circles on there, five rings, and then straight lines above and below. Well, according to Plato, Atlantis was made of five rings with a piece in the center, which was a circle, and straight roads that made their way across those rings of land and water. Well, that's exactly what we've got there, five rings and straight roads. And knowing that orichalcum was found in the inner temple of Poseidon, and it's a sacred female metal, and these symbols should represent what's inside the temple, this is correct. This all seems to run together. So that's the first part of what we found. The second part gets more interesting, because we then decided, well, is this the only ring that's come from Atlantis? Because we can prove it's from Atlantis simply because of the alloy it's made from. The answer is no, it's not. There was another ring, the first ring, which Howard Carter used. And there's a fairly extensive story, which you can check in our article, about how he came upon it. But it was called the Ring of Atlantis. And he wore it simply because of the fact he wore a copy of it, not the original, a copy. He found it. He heard about it in France and read books about it. Again, you can see that in the article. And he took that ring into Tutankhamun's tomb. And of the 18 who walked in, only one was alive a year later and lived much longer, and that was Carter. And the reason was because he wore a copy of that ring, which is still around. Now, that ring, according to the people who possess it and examined it, is supposed to be able to deflect and negate all negative energy, whether visible or invisible. Now, if you're going into the tomb of Tutankhamun, that's what I'd want to be wearing, and he did. And that's why he lived and the rest died. That's the first ring. Well, this one here, and that ring was made from the earth. We believe this ring here, which is made, is metal, and a third ring, which is also metal, have as much power. But the difference is, in these cases, is you've got one which we believe is purely good, which is what Carter had. One would sit somewhere in the middle, which is 5 and 4, the symbols here, 5 and 4, and I think 5 represents good, 4 evil, at different levels of meaning with this particular ring here. And then you've got another ring, and we're led to believe that's the opposite of pure good, which is pure evil. Now, I know this does sound a bit like Tolkien insofar as there are supposed to be 3 rings, but 3 is a sacred number, and 3 is of everything. All things come in 3. And Carter had one, and it was called the pyramid. It was called the Ring of Atlantis. So that's one. This is 2. And here's the trick. I've got a strong suspicion. We can't turn the first ring on. This ring we've got, we're playing in the dark, although we're getting somewhere. We're getting to different places with it. But this ring is one, and there are 2 others. The second ring, which is somewhere in France at the moment with a family, I think they're in the same position as us, because it was originally found by an archaeologist, a French archaeologist, in the 1870s, There was no instruction manual, was it? And the third ring, which is purely evil, well, we believe that one is being born. And the person who has that ring knows how to work it. We think there are three rings. And then when you go back to Tolkien's story of the, yes, I know, the Lord of the Rings, don't forget it was a Scandinavian myth that he took this upon. Because we all know all myths are supposedly fictional. That's what we're told in the books, but I don't believe that. Irrespective, he based it on a myth of three rings that had ultimate power throughout the world or throughout that particular time. Could that have been taken from Atlantis? And in Atlantis were there three rings, and they were in balance for a while. But it's perhaps, just perhaps, this ring here, the one we've got, which sits in the middle, wavers between one way and the other. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not, depending on who wears it. And perhaps it was a time when two rings were worn, and that's why Atlantis fell. Can't be sure. But the one thing, oh, this is so difficult, there's one thing we can tell you, and you can read some instances of why we're going to say this in the article. And all that mythology, the reason why people dismiss it is because the word magic goes along with these particular items and whatever they are, whether they be rocks, skulls, or in this case, rings. The trick here with this ring is that, as much as I've never said this before so openly, I basically challenge the ring and said, if you are as magic as you claim, if this is what this ring is about, then prove it to me. And don't leave it in a way where there's room for the rational mind to sit in. Do something that is utterly miraculous. And then I'll start saying this ring is magic and life. Well, that happened. But it's no point in me telling you what it is, because it'll make no difference. The ones who want to believe will believe it, the ones who don't won't. So there's no point discussing what it is. It's my business anyway. If you don't want to believe me, it's fine by me. But it did happen. And what I can tell you is that ring's alive. And it's got a power. And when it showed itself, it wasn't through me doing anything. It decided how and when and what. And after about 10 minutes, I decided I didn't want to do it anymore. Not that it was harmful, just because I understood fully. The ring, I wanted proof, and I got it. So this ring is around for a reason. It's been found now. There's three of them. And what that all means, well, that's a work in motion. We're still working on it. The one thing I can tell you is the ring was found over a metre beneath the surface in New South Wales, a place called Hill End. Shouldn't have been there. It's too deep. Shouldn't have been there. It's way before Cook. It's way before a lot of things. But it seems to me that the ring's come back for a reason. And I'm sort of hoping that ring in France is starting to resonate again too, because I can tell you something now, the way things are, we need some help from somewhere, because we certainly aren't getting from the people who are supposed to give it to us. So maybe these rings and maybe Tolkien could be right. But let me leave you with one thought. Tolkien's thesis is basically about three rings for the Elven kings and one ring that rules them all. One part's right, but the second one isn't. It can never be one ring that rules them all when there's three. It can only be two. And at the moment, one's awake and running on full speed, and the other two are sitting in neutral. So we know which one's in the ascendancy. And unless things change in a hurry, we've got problems ahead.